Hello, welcome everybody to another financial analysis video with myself, Moeed Amin, and my colleague, Ted Wayman. Today, it's a bit of a drinks theme day, actually. We're going to be looking at the largest privately owned spirits company in the world, and that is Bacardi. Now, Bacardi are quite famous, as you all know, from their eponymous Bacardi drinks, but that's not the only thing that they do. You know, they have, let me look at my notes, Grey Goose, they have Patron, which they acquired, I believe it was 2018, for $5.1 billion, you know, Martini and Bombay Sapphire. So they've got quite a good range of brands within the business. Now, this company was a request from one of our viewers. So this is for Matthew Newport. So Matthew, here is your video. We're going to dive, so stick around actually, because we're going to dive into the financials that we're able to find. So the clue is in the fact that I said they're a privately owned company, and we'll go into what we've been able to find. One thing to note, again, don't forget to like, share, subscribe. And if you're a subscriber, hopefully Matthew is, he will receive his video and instant notification when we publish this video. One point to note, the purpose for these videos Ted and I are doing, they are to help educate people in terms of being able to read, understand, and analyze financial information. How you use that information, how you use that analysis and newfound knowledge is entirely up to you. We are not here as a stocks and share or investment advice channel. That is not what we do. We're just helping educate as many people as possible on the really important skill of being able to read finances. As Warren Buffett says, if you can't understand language of business, then you can't really do business very well. So that is the purpose for this. So whether you're using this information for your investment thesis, which is a core part of, great. If you're using this because you want to sell services to Bacardi, and I have a client in the software and consulting business, and they sell those types of services and products to FMCG businesses, including drinks businesses. Great. If you're someone that's going to have an interview with someone like Bacardi or one of their competitors, I'm going to tell you now, as someone that's interviewed people, there is no smarter way you can present yourself than if you talk about the finances of the company and your contribution to those finances. So however you use this videos, that is up to you. But we are not here to help you look at the future. This is just the backward-looking metrics, backward-looking information. So with that, Ted, let's share what we found with our viewers, particularly around a company like this, which is privately owned. You have to do a bit more digging in certain areas to find the finances.
You're right. So good to see you, Moeed. Thank you very much. Yes. Bacardi, if you look up Bacardi annual report and accounts on the internet, you're not going to find very much because they are based in Bermuda and therefore they can take advantage of the secrecy laws in Bermuda and they don't have to publish the report and accounts. So finding out exactly how they're performing as a group is a little bit difficult. Fortunately, here in the UK, if you are a UK company, and this is every company in the UK, must by law prepare their financial statements and must file them with Companies House. So we've been to Companies House and here are the report for Bacardi UK. Now, if you were to look at Bacardi UK and we were to go down to page 12, we're just going to whiz down to page 12, we will see the income statement for this company. And you'll notice that they incur 28,000 of administrative expenses and the finance expenses of £12 million. And this isn't looking too good. They've got some finance income and income from subsidiaries and liquidation. And quite frankly, you know, this clearly is not the business that we want to be looking at. You know, to a certain extent, the trail goes cold there. Page 26 of these report and accounts, remember, these are available, publicly available, companieshouse.co.uk. They always tell us who the ultimate parent company is. So the directors of Bacardi Limited, that's the UK company, the directors regard Bacardi Limited, which is incorporated in Bermuda, as the ultimate parent and controlling company, is the largest group to consolidate these results. If we go to Bermuda, they're going to say, no chance, you're not having a look at them. The company that heads the smallest group of undertakings is Bacardi Martini, BV, the immediate parent company, and is registered in the Netherlands. Now, for reasons which I'm not absolutely certain, if we carry on scrolling down to page 34 of these accounts, we suddenly get Bacardi Martini BV. So actually, they've included the financial statements of Bacardi Martini BV. Now, this is obviously registered in the Netherlands, and they're reporting their information in here in the UK. So exactly why they're doing that, I'm not sure, whether this was just left attached to the accounts by mistake or whether they've done it on purpose, I'm not absolutely certain, but we'll have a look at this company. But this is not the full picture. This is probably, and I'm guessing here, this is their European operation, probably run through the Netherlands, and this is going to exclude Americas, Asia, Southern America, et cetera, so let's have a look at these numbers. You'll notice that they're reported in dollars. Dollars are thousands, and so the turnover for this company is 4.3 million thousand or thousand million, which is $4.3 billion. So that's this number up here. So $4.3 billion, about a 2% increase on the previous year. The cost of sales is about 3 billion, leaving with a gross profit of about 1.4 billion. That cost of sales is about 70%. So it's worth bearing that in mind, that, you know, when you buy a glass of martini, for every dollar you're paying, it's costing them about 70 cents to actually make the contents of that martini, for example. Which, you know, doesn't seem unreasonable, leaves them with a 30% or 32% gross margin. Another 24% on operating costs, leaving them with an operating profit, $350 million, which is about an 8% margin. If we scroll a little bit further down the income statement down to the bottom, we'll notice that these guys, there's some interest expense. So this number here suggests that they've got some debt sitting on the balance sheet, but that debt is, you know, affordable, just. And they're paying some tax and after other bits and pieces. And also we notice here amortization of goodwill. We'll talk about that in a minute. Their result after tax is a small loss. Compared, interestingly enough, to the previous year of a significant profit. And the reason for the difference really comes from here. Results from participation. So participations will be, other non-consolidated companies who are pumping their results into these guys. And you'll notice that there was $925 million, nearly $1 billion in the previous year, and a pretty small number in this year. So, you know, we can go and have a look at note seven and just find out exactly what that is. And we'll look at that in a minute. This amortization of goodwill, so amortization, for the regular viewers will remember, that is effectively depreciation by another name. We depreciate tangible assets and we amortize intangible assets, things we can't touch. Goodwill is an intangible asset. Goodwill arises on acquisition of another company. It's the difference between what you pay for it and the fair value of the net assets, i.e. effectively the equity on the balance sheet. So in effect, what this is saying is that these guys, alluded to that, Moeed, when you talked about, recent acquisitions and sizable acquisitions. When Bacardi is growing, it's buying existing labels. It'll buy Canada Goose or Grey Goose, for example. Not Canada Goose, of course, but Grey Goose. So it's going to buy the label. It's going to pay more than the value of the net assets because it's really buying the brand value. So a lot of goodwill will arise on that acquisition, and then that goodwill is just being amortized and written off over time. So you can see these are pretty similar numbers year on year. This is a non-accounting expense, $44 or $47 million. Let's move on, look at the balance sheet. So here's the balance sheet. So intangible assets. So up at the top, we've got the fixed assets. These are the non-current assets at the top. Easily the biggest number is the intangible assets. And this will be, you can look in note five if you want, but I can tell you now that is going to be goodwill. So that will be arising on acquisition. So this is basically saying Bacardi has got to the size it is by buying existing brands. Okay, and that kind of makes sense. It's got a big distribution network. It buys a really good brand, plugs it in. And so if you're traveling anywhere in the world and you end up in duty free, for example, the reason that, for example, Grey Goose is on the shelves is because Bacardi is already there and they just took a great brand like Grey Goose, plug it into their distribution and off they go. So that's really the kind of the kind of the growth strategy here, rather than building brands from scratch, which is pretty hard work. They've just acquired them, and that is reflected in their income, in their balance sheet. They got some tangible assets as well, so that'll be sort of their production facilities, and some financial fixed assets, which may be intercompany loans, for example. In their current assets section, they've got the sort of what you'd expect, so inventories, accounts receivable, and then the cash as well. So all of these numbers down here, and a reasonable amount of cash sitting on the balance sheet. Total assets, about $9.3 billion. Scroll down a little bit to the bottom half of the balance sheet, and we see down here, we've got the sort of the current liabilities. Quite interesting, we can compare. Don't forget the current liabilities, that's this number here. Quick little comparison to the current assets. That's our kind of our rule of thumb liquidity ratio, and it suggests that these guys are pretty liquid. And the ratio, let me just read out my ratio if I can find it, because I've already calculated it. So the ratio there is for every dollar they owe, they've got $1.43 either as of cash or coming in as cash soon. However, quite interesting for this company, inventories is quite large, $1.6 billion. Don't forget, turnover is $4.2 billion. So, you know, that suggests that, you know, they're sitting on an awful lot of inventory there. Sort of back of an envelope calculation suggests that it takes them 200 days to actually shift that inventory. Now, it's not going to go off. You know, they've got some nice whiskies or vodkas there. Their shelf life is very, very long. It's not very long in my house, I have to admit, but that's more consumption, speed of consumption than anything else. But, you know, but 200 days sounds quite a long time to me. They've got these accounts receivable, and the accounts receivable, again, now this is owed by affiliate companies, and they've also got their sort of their actual, but if you look at their actual accounts receivable, and you plug those in, then it's suggesting it's taking them 60 days to collect the money in, and they're paying out 45 days. So that's putting a little bit of a, you know, that kind of, that inventory days is putting a bit of a strain on their cash flow, which means that they do need to maintain that liquidity. Now, again, we don't know for those sales. Are those sales to other associate companies or group companies, or are they sales externally? You know, we don't know that. So, you know, that's why we like to tend to, if we can at an analysis level, is to look at the kind of the headline, you know, the top level, the parent company, because that gives us, you know, how the group deals with the external world and not how it trades between itself. Other items on the balance sheet, they've got you know, quite a lot of equity, $3.2 billion of equity. That's this number in here. So there's the equity. They've got a few non-current liabilities, so a bit of debt sitting there, and we expect that a very small amount of sort of overdrafts, etc. But you know, a little bit of debt, and that's why they're paying interest. But nothing really kind of jumping out as alarm bells. It looks a pretty strong balance sheet, as we would probably expect from a company like this. We then come onto the cash flow statement, and the cash flow. Interesting enough, in the previous year, they had a cash loss. So this net generated cash from trading activities, negative $113 million, it's now gone positive. That's quite a big number, quite interesting as to exactly what is going on there. And a lot of that, I think, is this kind of this movement in working capital. So what we see here is the receivables. So what's happened to their receivables? They've gone down. Either people who owe them the people who owe them money, they have not been collected, and they've increased, and that's put a negative effect on their cash flow. Their inventories have been rising. Their inventories are high anyway, and the current liabilities is effectively the payables, and the payables they have been paying, and therefore that's put a negative strain on their cash flow. So, you know, those look, reasonable numbers. So I wouldn't get too worried about that. I think, you know, core business is that these guys, you know, they are generating cash, and then they're just using some of that cash to manage their working capital. If we scroll further down, we can see their investment activities. So here is, there's a big acquisition going on. I'm not sure exactly who it is. We can look at note four if we want to find out. So it would have been a particular brand or a company who they'd have bought, and they would have funded that through the issue of debt. Okay, so here we can see the issue of debt plus equity together is funding this acquisition. That was in the previous year. Looking at this year, the investment is, you know, kind of just ticking along. So, you know, I mean, they're obviously big numbers. It's $105 million, but it's not, you know, in the scheme of things, we're not up at the $3.6 kind of billion acquisition business. And no real change in terms of the financing. So just ticking along there. So, you know, really they've got a reasonable amount of cash sitting on the balance sheet at the end of the day. They are, you know, they're generating cash. Again, there's nothing really that's, you know, looks, jumps out at us from that. And that's really kind of, that's all the financial analysis that, you know, we can do, Moeed. So, this results from participations, again, big old number there, leading to a big old number down the bottom. And we don't see that this year. Be interesting to see whether that kind of carries on at that kind of level going forward, or whether there's any other changes. There's no share price to talk about, because of course they are a privately listed company. So, you know, would I do business with these guys? Yeah, absolutely. It looks like their payment terms are pretty friendly. You know, they're paying 45 days, it looks like, on average. You know, that sounds pretty good to me, to an organization of this kind of size and potential financial muscle. They are taking 60 days to collect the money due to them. Again, you know, is that reasonable? It depends on the kind of the jurisdictions they're operating in. I just think, you know, maybe, if I was running this business, I'd be looking at their inventory control. It looks to me like, you know, there's a warehouse somewhere with an awful lot of bottles of Bacardi sitting on the shelves waiting to be sold. Maybe they could sell them to number 10 who enjoy a party, obviously, at the moment. So there you go, Moeed. Not a lot I can add to that.
No, and actually that was quite a lot, to be honest. There's a ton of information there in order to help any sellers or anyone who's looking at working with similar types of businesses and being able to do a comparison there. So that was very interesting indeed. So again, if anyone has any, you know, deep knowledge of this industry and would like to share that knowledge with the rest of the community, do leave a note in the comment section. And also, if there's a particular company that you would like for us to analyze for you and give you some practical walkthrough of how to look at some of these financial statements, do leave a note in the comment section again. And please leave some details around the context for why you're interested in us looking at this company for you. You know, is it about investment? Is it about selling to them? Is it about an interview that you have coming up, or something else? So till the next video, thank you very much, Ted. Thank you, everyone else. We'll see you on the next video.
Catch you later, Moeed.